फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल एसएम लेक्चर सीरीज। योर ओनली स्टॉप टू गेट ऑल द नॉलेज ऑफ फाइनाइट एलिमेंट एनालिसिस, कैडकैम, सीएई एंड मेनी अदर सब्जेक्ट्स। ऑल्सो योर वन स्टॉप डेस्टिनेशन टू लर्न सॉफ्टवेयर्स लाइक सॉलिड वर्क्स, मास्टर कैम, ऑटोडेस्क फ्यूजन 360 एंड मेनी मोर टू कम। प्लीज डू लाइक, शेयर एंड सब्सक्राइब माय चैनल टू स्टे अपडेटेड विद द लेटेस्ट नॉलेज। थैंक यू। हेलो फ्रेंड्स, इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी विल सी द इंटरपोलेशन फंक्शंस, शेप फंक्शंस इन ब्रीफ, एंड वी विल देन ट्राय एंड जनरेट द एलिमेंट मैट्रिक्स इक्वेशन फॉर ए जनरल सेकंड ऑर्डर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन। So let's get started with this. So interpolation function is a trial function, just we have seen it in the one of the weighted residual methods. Okay, so interpolation function is a trial method, a trial function for a element. Now when we try to formulate the finite element method based on the RR method, that is Rayleigh-Ritz method, okay, we take the same steps. So in other words, it is based on the weighted residual methods analogy. So whatever steps we have followed to come at a solution in weighted residual methods, we apply similar set of methods in finite element method, and here we apply those methods to an element. So the element will have its own function. Just as the same the differential equation, okay, in order to solve the differential equation with approximate methods, we used to assume a trial function. Okay, similar to that, here the element will have a trial function, and that trial function we call as interpolation function. And as we have seen in the weighted residual methods, the every method has a different procedure to select weight function, which is nothing but a function of independent variable x. Okay, in a similar manner, okay, analogous to this procedure, in the finite element method we will have shape functions. Okay, so shape functions are weight functions for elements, and trial functions or approximate functions are interpolation functions for elements. So interpolation function is a trial function for element. Okay, now if you remember, we had various ways to select the interpolation function. Okay, so we will be having various ways to define the interpolation function and in terms of the finite element method. So if we are going to see a two noded linear bar element, let's say the element looks like this. So element will have two nodes, okay, node number one, node number two, joined by this line. Okay, and it is called as a linear bar element. Okay, linear bar element. Okay, now the interpolation function for this linear bar element happens to be, okay, we will define the interpolation function with the same variable u as we have defined the approximate function. Okay, and here we will define the interpolation function as, let's say, c0 plus c1x. Okay, if it is a linear bar element, so now there is a direct analogy. So linear bar element, behavior of this element is linear. Okay, behavior of this element is linear. Now if you remember, okay, which type of differential equation will give us a linear behavior? Okay, so let's say we can say one dimensional differential equation, okay, or first order differential equation will be giving us a linear behavior to certain extent, we can say, just to develop the analogy. So in that sense, okay, we used a for first order differential equation, okay, we used in their the rules which we defined, okay, to come up with an approximate function. There we said the order of differential equation, if it is 1, then we will have the highest power of the approximate function will be 1 plus the order of differential equation. So at that time we had selected the approximate function as c0 plus c1x plus c2x square. Okay, and then we applied the boundary condition and reduced the unknown parameters. Okay, and we got a 2-parameter approximate function with 2 unknown parameters still remaining in it. Now here what we are going to do is and then we said that the behavior of such element, okay, is, or behavior of such equation is linear in nature because it has got 2 unknown equations or 2 unknown parameters. So on the same case, now here we are not going to apply any boundary conditions as such while trying to come up with an interpolation function. Okay, so if we say that, okay, if we say that the linear bar element, okay, will have this kind of an equation. If we are talking about writing the equation in terms of the unknown parameters and the independent variable, then what is the next element? If I just increase the order of element to, let's say, 2, then I will have, let's say, quadratic bar element. So this is a quadratic bar element. Now quadratic bar element will have a quadratic behavior, and quadratic behavior can be captured with this equation. Okay, so now you can see it depends on how many nodes your element is having, that many unknown parameters your interpolation function should have. So that is the direct analogy that we can develop. The third element is a cubic element. Okay, so it is called as cubic bar element. Okay, all are bar elements. Okay, all are one dimensional elements. Okay, all are one dimensional elements. So their interpolation function will be given by, since there are 4 nodes, so it will have 4 unknown parameters. So c1x plus c2x square plus c3x cube. Okay, now don't get confused. Okay, this 1 and 2, these are not 2 linear bar elements joined together. This is an element with 3 nodes. Okay, element with 3 nodes. This is a single element only. So that is why when it has 3 nodes, the behavior of the element is quadratic in nature, because the interpolation function will have power 2, okay, highest power as 2. And this is again a element having an element having 4 nodes. So it is an element with 4 nodes having behavior like cubic behavior, because the highest power in the interpolation function is 3. Okay, so this is as far as what was analogous with the weighted residual methods. Now if in general we want to write, okay, in general we want to write the interpolation function, let's say, what we can say, interpolation function is given by u is equal to, okay, I will write here summation I equal to 1 to n, okay, I equal to 1 to n, and I will write over here n I multiplied by u I. Now let's say where n is degrees of freedom, or degree of freedom, okay, of the element. Okay, degree of freedom of the element. Since we are talking about one dimensional elements, okay, we are talking about one dimensional elements only at this point of time, it is also equal to number of nodes. Okay, number of nodes in the element. Okay, now degree of freedom is, the general definition of degree of freedom is the number of independent motion an object can have in an open space. Okay, so an object in an open space can be moved, okay, in let's say respectively translationally, let's say x direction translation to and fro, y direction to and fro, z direction to and fro, and it can be rotated about these three axes independently. So you can roughly say 6 degrees of freedoms, okay, in an open space. But we are not actually talking about the unconstrained degree of freedom definition over here. We are talking about what is the allowed you can say movement of the element, okay, at that particular node, or you can say the movement of or you can say the value of primary variable which we are looking at a particular node. So this node, okay, node number 1, node number 2, okay, is allowed to move only along x direction. So this node number 1 can be moved only to and fro in x direction, and this also can be only moved to and fro in x direction because it is only one directional. Okay, it is only one directional, and that is the reason why we call these type of elements as one dimensional elements. Okay, one dimensional elements. So let's say I will write it over here. Okay, one dimensional elements. Okay, they have existence only in one dimension. Okay, they have existence only in one dimension. That is why we call them as one dimensional elements. Now, if they have existence only in one dimension, we can say this can be moved, let's say, to and fro here. So to and fro is only single translational motion. Don't take it as positive motion 1 and negative motion, or the to and fro, these are 2 degrees of freedom. No, we don't count it that way. So it is the x directional movement. Okay, you can say if I have to define the coordinate system, let's say here there is some far x, okay, or the far origin, and in the horizontal direction x will be measured. So this node, which is a fixed point basically, okay, can be or a defined point, okay, can be moved in, okay, has possibility to record the value, okay, only in x direction. So that is one. And also this node has possibility to record the value again in x direction. So now there are two nodes which got possibility to record value only in x direction. So that makes the degree of freedom as at this particular node I have 1 degree, at this particular node I have 1 degree. So 1 plus 1, okay, the total degree of freedom of the element has become 2, or in other words you can say total number of nodes of that element are 2. Okay, same happens with this node as well. So now I have node number of nodes as 3. Okay, so my DOF of DOF of this element is 3. Okay, and same I will write for here, okay, cubic element. So DOF is 4 because my number of nodes are 4. So in that same context, okay, in that same context, what happens is okay, okay, if it is going to have, let's say, a linear bar element, okay, linear bar element, then okay, I know that n is equal to 2 for linear bar element. So what will be the interpolation function? The interpolation function would simply go like this: I equal to 1 to 2, okay, n I u I, which will eventually give me, since it's a summation, I will have n1 u1 plus n2 u2, where, okay, this capital N is called as shape functions. Okay, so I will represent them by ni, and then ui, these are called as primary variables at respective ith node position. Okay, now similarly for the other element, okay, similarly for the other element, I can very well write it as, let's say, quadratic bar element. I can write this as u equal to summation I equal to 1 to 3 NiUi, which will eventually give me N1U1 plus N2U2 plus N3U3, and same for the cubic bar element. Okay, I will have this as N1U1 plus N2U2 plus N3U3 plus N4U4. Okay, now, so now you must have understood how we change the concept, okay, from the approximate function to a interpolation function. Okay, and this is completely based on the similar concept. Okay, based on the similar concept, and all these are one dimensional elements only. Okay, all these are one dimensional elements only. So we are increasing the number of nodes in an element by making the calculating part slightly difficult. Okay, we as far as possible try to restrict ourselves to a cubic bar element only. Okay, we can certainly have more nodes in an element. Okay, let's say if I can have 5 nodes in an element, 6 nodes in a bar element. Okay, but only thing is my calculation is going to become very difficult. Okay, my calculation is going to become very difficult, and nature of element is also going to go on a complex side. So cubic is a nature of element. It will become fourth order, it will become fifth order, and so on, and it would have those many number of, let's say, shape function and primary variable combinations, and in a way it will be difficult to find out all those shape functions. Okay, so that is the reason why in manual calculations we restrict ourselves as this course is concerned to 4 nodes in a bar element, so up to cubic bar element. Now the next thing is we will find what exactly is shape function. So shape function, okay, as the name suggests, okay, has something to do with the shape of the element. Okay, what kind of shape it gives us, and what kind of shape we can analyze. Okay, the geometry we can analyze with a particular element. So if we have knowledge of its shape functions, okay, then we can probably decide in a typical geometry which element we should use. Okay, so these are nothing but they talk about geometry of the element, and these are nothing but weight functions. Okay, shape functions are nothing but weight functions, and as we have already seen, they are denoted by N, letter N. Okay, in some other books or in other literatures, you will also find they are denoted by some other notations, but they are shape functions, one and the same. Okay, and these are related with geometry of the element. So you can say related with the geometry of the element. And they have a very good property. So summations of all the shape functions, okay, over the entire element is always 1. So let's say I have this linear bar element. Okay, linear bar element. So how many shape functions I have for linear bar element? I have 2 shape functions. Okay, I have 2 shape functions. So let's say this linear bar element, I am having 2 shape functions. So N1 plus N2 will always be 1. Okay, N1 plus N2 will always be 1. This is the property of shape function. This is a very important property. Based on this property, later on we can identify various shape functions, okay, of the element. And that is the reason why if I differentiate this with respect to the independent variable, okay, I get 0. Okay, I get 0. So this is the shape function property. Okay, shape function property. Now in the coming what we will see now is the element matrix equation generation. Okay, element matrix equation generation for a general differential equation. Okay, so this is the element matrix equation. So this is the general form of the differential equation with A, C, Q acting as constants. So I have a second order differential equation with a primary variable, the second differential of primary variable, then primary variable itself, then a constant term present in the differential equation. So I write this differential equation in global coordinates. Okay, as we all know that there are basically three coordinate systems. The first one is a global coordinate system, then second is a local coordinate system, and then there is a natural coordinate system. Some may call it as there are two coordinate systems, global and natural, global and local, and with local further divided into two parts, that is local and natural. So you call it anyway. There are total three coordinate systems which we can work with, okay, in finite element analysis. So global coordinate system remains to be the global Cartesian coordinate system. Okay, so it will have an origin far away from the plane of interest, or the place of interest basically, and every dimension will be taken from that far origin. Since it is a one dimensional coordinate system, okay, one dimensional coordinate system, so let's say if I have to showcase that, then let's say it will have a very far origin, and if I have to showcase, let's say, linear bar element in terms of the global coordinates, then it would something look like this. This is going to be the x, this is the global origin, so all the dimensions will be from this. So this is nothing but my x1. Okay, so I better write it here, x1, which is this dimension, and similarly this is my x2, okay, which is this dimension. Okay, so okay, this is what my global coordinate system looks like. Okay, it will have a global reference, okay, and the origin, global reference origin, which will be away from the place of interest, in this particular case the element. Okay, the first node is at distance x1 from the global origin. The second node is at the distance x2 from the global origin, and if I have to find out the extent of element, okay, extent means the length of element, then it is going to be x2 minus x1, okay, in terms of its global coordinate system. Okay, so when we are representing anything in global coordinate systems, we simply change the references to a capital letter references. So let's say the x, the independent variable x, then the primary variable u, okay, these two are the main variables in our differential equation. I have turned them into capital letters, so these are represented in global coordinates. Okay, I rearrange the terms and then I represent them in a non-weak integral form. So non-weak integral form, we know that we will be multiplying the differential equation with a weight function w, and we will be integrating over the entire domain. Now domain will be selected slightly later, domain boundaries, based on the element analysis that we are going to carry out. Okay, so if we are working with global coordinate systems, then we will use the global margins over here, the domain margins, okay, global domain margins. If we are using local coordinate systems, then we will use the local margins, so that we will come to it in a short way. Then I represent it in a non-weak integral form, so multiply this with w and I separate out the term, so each term gets multiplied with w. So what happens is w multiplied by d by dx of a du by dx, okay, minus w multiplied by cu dx dx minus integration of w multiplied by q dx, okay, over the entire domain. Now what we do is we use the weak integral form which we have used for the RR method, that is Rayleigh-Ritz method. So what we call, we make use of the integration by parts. So there we only consider that term which is having w getting multiplied with the highest differential order term in the differential equation. So highest differential order term is this, which is the second order term. So I call w as u and the second order term as v, and apply the integration by parts and simplify. Okay, this is what we have seen in last lecture as well. So when I simplify, I get a bilinear term which has W and U in same differential power. Then I also get one more bilinear term, you can say, with W and U in same differential power. Then I get a second order term, okay, ready second order term, secondary variable term, which is coming readily. This is basically the first part of the integration by parts, which happens to come out of the integration, and I just have to apply the integration limits. I cannot further integrate this. This is already integrated, and I will have to apply the limits, and then the constant term Q integration W dx. Okay, now here we make use of the element analysis. Okay, here we make use of the element analysis. So let's say so I have this element which is linear bar element. Okay, now I am using this element with a local coordinate system. Okay, element analysis in local coordinates. Now we have already seen global coordinates. So for global coordinates, the origin is away from the element. Now in local coordinates, the origin is, let's say if it is a two-noded element, the element will be on the left. The origin for the local coordinate is going to be the left node. So here it is going to be x equal to 0. Okay, and here it is going to be x equal to L. So this is my local coordinate system. In this, extent of element, okay, extent of element is going to be L. Okay, extent of element will become, let's say, L minus 0, that is L. Okay, so that is the length of element. Okay, that is the length of element. Now I am interested to showcase my primary variables over here. So these are my primary variables, displacements. Okay, also I will be interested to showcase the secondary variables, okay, at this place. So these are my secondary variables. Okay, so u1 u2 are the primary variables. Okay, we know primary variables are let's say displacements in the structural field problem, and secondary variables are going to be forces. Okay, so we are following a spring analogy equation, you can say. So this is the spring stiffness, okay, multiplied by the displacement of the spring recorded after applying the force. Okay, after applying the force. So let's say we know that force is proportional to the amount of displacement recorded by the spring, and force, if I have to make it equal, I will have to include the constant of proportionality, okay, which we call as spring stiffness. Okay, which we call as spring stiffness. Okay, with a unit. What will be the unit? Unit here is going to be Newton per meter, or you can say Newton per millimeter. Okay, this is going to be the unit of the stiffness. Okay, so this stiffness plays a very vital role, and we will be using this spring analogy to come up with a similar set of equations, wherein in our case these equations are going to be matrix equations. Okay, so we'll come to that slowly, but this kind of spring analogy we are going to use to derive the set of equations, element equations, in terms of the element that is two noded linear bar element. Okay, now we know that in local coordinate systems, okay, it will have shape functions. So this will have shape function n1 at node number 1. This will have shape function n2 at node number 1. Now I know that shape function has something to do with the geometry of element. Now this is a one dimensional element. So I can very well say the primary variable, okay, primary variable is the displacement. Okay, but I can say that the shape function is proportional, okay, proportional to whatever equation that I can derive for node 1, and again equation that I can derive for node 2. Okay, so what would be that equation? So that equation is nothing but, okay, in terms of the local coordinate variable. Okay, so you can see the striking difference between global coordinate variables and local coordinate variables. In global coordinates, I have used capital letters everywhere. In local coordinates, I will be using small case letters just to differentiate them, okay, with respect to each other. So the kinds of equations that we can write at these particular nodes in terms of the independent variable. Okay, the one equation is this x, okay, x equal to 0. So shape function will be proportional to x equal to 0. Now we have said shape functions are related with geometry of element. Now what is defining the geometry? Geometry is defined by this independent variable. Okay, so this is showcased around this horizontal direction x. So that is why this is proportional to x. Okay, so what is going to be the equation at this? Okay, if I bring everything on one side, this should give me x minus l equal to 0. Okay, this should give me x minus l equal to 0. So I can say shape function is also proportional to x minus l. So if I combine these two things, I can say shape function is proportional to x multiplied by x minus l. And if I have to make it equal, then shape function can be equal to some shape factor multiplied by x multiplied by x minus l. Okay, some shape factor multiplied by x minus 1. Now if we have to find out the values of particular shape function, okay, at a particular node, so how many shape functions this particular element has? This has two shape functions, n1 and n2. So if I have to find the values of these two shape functions, okay, what I will have to do is, okay, I will use the shape function property. So let's say at node 1, okay, at node 1, okay, in order to derive the equation, okay, we'll have to omit some terms from this common equation which we just identified. So how to do that? Okay, at node 1, we know that shape function will have value n1, and if we are only concerned, okay, let's say, remember the property of shape function. What the property of shape function says? The property of shape function says the summation of shape functions at all the entire element is 1. So if we are finding the value of shape function at node number 1, then it has to be 1. Okay, and at the same time, the value of n1 at node 2 will always be 0. Okay, value of shape function n1 at node 2 will always be 0. So value of shape function at its own node, okay, value of shape function at its own node will be always 1. Okay, so what we do is, in order to find the shape factor, okay, shape factor, what we do is we delete this x, okay, we delete this x from this equation, and we rewrite this equation as n equal to n1 equal to sf multiplied by x minus l. And we also know that at node number 1, the value of x is 0. So we put all these values back into this. So we have already seen at node number 1, n1 is 1. So 1 is equal to shape factor multiplied by 0 minus l. So eventually we get shape factor as minus 1 by l. Okay, shape factor as minus 1 by l. And that gives us n1 as, okay, if I just put this value, minus 1 by l, x minus l. So in other words, okay, if I take that minus sign out, okay, so I will have 1 minus x by l. Okay, 1 minus x by l. Now, similarly, if I find this at, let's say, node 2, okay, at node 2, see what we have found out. We have found out the value of shape function. Okay, we have found out the value of shape function using the local coordinate system, okay, at node number 1. Similarly, at node 2, what is going to happen? N is equal to n2 is equal to 1, and x value at node 2 is l. So while finding the value of n2, we'll have to omit this x minus l term. Why we have to omit? Because if we include this term, then the equation doesn't exist. Okay, it will just give us 0. So I write here as n equal to n2 equal to my shape factor, okay, multiplied by x. Now I know that n2 is 1 at node number 2. So shape factor is nothing but x value is l. So my shape factor is just comes out to be 1 by l. And eventually my n2 is x by l. Okay, so this is what my shape functions are. Okay, these are what my shape functions are at using the local coordinate system. Okay, using the local coordinate system. So with this, I go back to the problem at hand. So now I know that I will be using a local coordinate system and I will be using an element analysis. So extent of element is what? From 0 to L. So x equal to 0 to x equal to L. So now I know that the domain limits are between 0 to L. Okay, at every places I will be using small case letters because it is a local coordinate system. So in place of this, I will just write okay, 0 to L dw by dx du by dx dx plus 0 to L w u dx is equal to between the limit 0 to L and plus q integration 0 to L w d. Okay, now we have already found out the interpolation and shape function, so we'll just rewrite them over here. So interpolation and shape functions are given by interpolation function is what? N1 u1 plus n2 u2, which is nothing but what? 1 minus x by l u1 plus x by l u2, that is going to be my interpolation function. And the shape functions are nothing but the 1 minus x by l and x by l. Now in this differential equation, okay, we want first differential order of this, so I'll just differentiate this du by dx, which eventually comes out to be minus u1 by l plus u2 by l. And also I know shape functions, let's say n1 is 1 minus x by l and which is nothing but w1. Okay, so when I write dw1 by dx, okay, dw1 by dx is going to be what? Minus 1 by l, and n2 is equal to w2 is equal to x by l. And when I'm going to write dw2 by dx, is going to give me 1 by l. It is going to give me 1 by l. So now I have found out all these values. Now I will have to solve this equation separately for w1 and w2. Okay, separately for w1 and w2. So I will first solve for w1. So let's say first rewrite this with w1 keeping in that equation. Okay, and then last is q integration 0 to l w1 dx. Okay, now we know all these terms. Okay, so we will start putting them inside this equation. Okay, so what we get is so dw1 by dx is basically minus 1 by l multiplied by it is minus u1 by n plus u2 by n dx plus, see now why we have given a subscript e, c subscript e. So this is just showing the element analysis. So our domain may be large, but now we have considered a small element of that domain and we are applying the local coordinate system and doing the equations for the small element, and then we will have a mechanism to propagate those equations over the entire domain and assemble those equations again. That will be the later part. So then W1 multiplied by U, okay, W1 multiplied by U, so it is going to be a big equation, 1 minus X by L multiplied by U is what? 1 minus x by n u1 plus x by n u2 dx is equal to, okay, for the time being, okay, we will keep this term as it is. Okay, so we'll use this as 1 minus x by n multiplied by a du by dx over the limit 0 to L, and then plus q multiplied by 0 to L 1 minus x by n dx, okay, 1 minus x by n dx. So when you solve them, okay, when you solve them, it's not that difficult to solve, you just have to integrate. You just have to integrate. So here I can take okay, and let us separate these out. So let us call this as integrand 1, let's call this as integrand 2, let us call this as integrand 2, and let us call this as integrand 3, and this as integrand 4. So now we have equations of the order integrand 1 plus integrand 2 is equal to integrand 3 plus integrand 4. So we'll solve integrand 1 first. So integrand 1 is, okay, if I take L common, so it will become, let's say, minus of AE by L square. This L will also come out of the integration. So 0 to L minus U1 plus U2 dx, which is nothing but, okay, if I just simplify, okay, and take the sign inside, okay, take the sign inside, then it will be what? U1 minus U2 is going to be my first integral. Okay, so what I will have here, over here, minus U1x plus U2x, so I will again take them common, so x multiplied by minus U1 plus U2, so it will become L multiplied by minus U1 plus U2. So L and this L square will get cancelled. So I will have in the denominator only L. If I take this inside, then minus U1 minus will become plus. So U1 minus U2. So not difficult to understand. Then integrand 2. Okay, we'll have to multiply that term inside. Okay, multiplied by, multiply that term inside. So let's say 1 minus x by L multiplied by 1 minus x by L. So 1 minus is going to be 2x by L, okay, plus x square by L square multiplied by u1, okay, plus, okay, 1 minus x multiplied by x by L will give me x by L minus x square by L square u2, okay, dx. So this is whole inside the integration. This whole inside the integration. Okay, so we can start solving them. Okay, we can start solving them. So basically, is like L minus N plus L by 3 multiplied by U1 plus is going to be L by 2 minus L by 3 U2. Okay, so if I just simplify this, okay, so this L and L will get cancelled. This is L by 3 U1 plus L by 6 U2. Okay, so this will be CE will stay outside, and what I have here is L by 3 U1 plus L by 6 U2. So this is what integrand 2 is. Now if I solve for integrand 3, so if you carefully look at integrand 3, it is 1 minus x by n multiplied by a du by dx, and just the limit is applied. So let us apply the limits. Okay, we'll not change this term for the timing. So if I put the upper limit, so that is 1 minus l by n multiplied by a du by dx minus 1 minus 0 by n a du by dx. What happens is this first term will give me 0 minus, I will have some second term. Okay, I will have some second term which is of the kind a du by dx. So that I call as a secondary variable f1. Okay, that I call as secondary variable f1. So I will write this as only minus f1. I'll write this one as only minus f1. And the last term, that is the fourth integrand, if I solve, that is 0 to L 1 minus x by n dx, which will eventually give me it is going to be what, x minus x square by 2l, okay, on the limit 0 to l. And when I simplify this, I will have, of course, it has QE outside as a constant term. So when I simplify this, this will become L minus L square by 2L. So L minus L by 2, basically, it will be L by 2. So that's what I have. So if I combine all of these integrands again, so 1 plus 2 equal to 3 plus 4, what I get is AE by L U1 minus U2 plus CE multiplied by L by 3 U1 plus L by 6 U2 is equal to minus F1 plus QE L by 2. So this is my equation 1 with W1. If you remember, we have started with W1. Now similarly, if I start with W2, so I will write over here for W2. Okay, so for W2 means I will have to write the entire equation in terms of W2. Okay, entire equation in terms of W2. So that will be this AE will stay outside, it is going to be dW2 by dx multiplied by dU by dx multiplied by dU by dx dx plus, this will stay outside, 0 to L W2 U dx equals to, okay, I have this W2 multiplied by a du by dx, okay, applied the limit 0 to n plus qe w2 dx. So again, if we do the same thing, okay, we call them as integrands 1 plus 2 is equal to plus 4 for the simplicity. So I will have integrand 1 equal to this AE will stay outside 0 to L. We know that dw by 2 is 1 by L multiplied by du by dx is minus u1 by L plus u2 by L dx. Okay, so if I solve this, I get it as L square will come out. It will be L multiplied by minus U1 plus U2. Okay, so it will be like AE by L minus U1 plus U2. This is going to be the first integrand. Then the second integrand is CE multiplied by 0 to L. Okay, W2 is W2 is x by L, so x by L change the thickness to 1. Yes, so this gives us W2 is x by L multiplied by one minus x by L u1 plus x by L u2 dx. So when we solve this, we get x by L minus x square by L square u1 plus x square by L square u2 dx. Okay, when you further solve and simplify, okay, you eventually get this as CE. Okay, when you apply the limits, it becomes L by 2 minus L by 3 U1 plus L by 3 U2. And when you simplify this, so it becomes as CE L by 6 U1 plus L by 3 U2. That is my integrand 2. Then I will have the integrand 3 as the similar lines. Okay, I will just mention the this W2 into A du by dx okay, over the limit, that is 0 to x, 0 to L. So here I have W2 is what? X by L multiplied by A du by dx 0 to L. So the first term is gonna give me L by L A du by dx minus 0 by L A du by dx. So I know that this term is gonna give me 0 and this term is only gonna give me A du by dx. So it is going to be A du by dx minus 0. So only A du by dx. So we call this as plus F2, which is going to be the secondary variable which is directly present. Okay, secondary variable directly present. And then the last term is integration QE multiplied by integration 0 to L W2 dx, and that eventually turns out to be 0 to L x by L dx, which is nothing but okay, it is x square by 2L. Okay, so if I say QE upon 2L will come out, okay, and it will be what? X square 0 to L. So if I simplify, put the limits, I will eventually get QE into L by 2. So when I combine this again into 1 plus 2 equal to 3 plus 4, okay, I get this in a form. AE by L minus U1 plus U2 plus CE, it is L by 6 U1 plus L by 3 U2 equals what we have got here, F2 plus QE L by 2. So this is my equation 2. So now if you carefully look these two equations, this equation 1 and equation 2, let me just bring this equation also down. Okay. Let's just put it here for the time being, and this further below this. Okay, so if you carefully look at these two equations, okay, it's possible to combine them in one equation. Okay, it's possible to combine them in one equation. So we will combine them in one matrix equation in this manner. Let's say I will say AE by N. Okay, pay attention carefully. Okay, I will write 1 minus 1 minus 1 1 multiplied by a column vector U1 U2 plus, I will have the CE. Okay, I will take a common factor out of the out of that as L by 6. Then I will write 2 1 1 2 multiplied by again one column vector U1 U2 is equal to one more column vector on the right hand side minus F1, that is first value, and then plus F2 plus. Again, I will have this QE L by 2 common 1 1. Okay, so when I combine them into a matrix equation, I get a matrix equation of this kind, and this is called as element matrix equation for a linear bar element, because we started with element analysis where we considered a linear bar. We found its shape functions, we found its corresponding approximate function, and then we implemented it inside the element analysis and solved those two equations and converted them into its equivalent matrix form. Okay, so the left hand side, okay, the left hand side has got a very important meaning. So if we are going to consider structural field problems, okay, thermal field problems without extended areas, then fluid flow problems, then our equation will consist of this term. This is called as stiffness matrix. Okay, this is also a kind of stiffness matrix, but this is only present in a thermal field problem with extended area. So it is only present wherever convection is involved. Okay, direct convection is involved. So this is called as a convection term. Okay, basically convection term. This is called as the force matrix, and this is called as the displacement matrix. Okay, and this matrix is present wherever we have distributed loading. Okay, distributed loading, just like in beams we have simply supported beams. Okay, on that we have distributed loading, similar to that. Okay, uniformly distributed load, uniformly varying load, whatever. Okay, can be considered on the right hand side in this way. Okay, so in normal conditions, okay, you will not have this matrix. Okay, normal conditions you will not have this matrix, this particular matrix, of course multiplied with this. Okay, so in a normal circumstance, okay, all the structural field problems, conduction heat transfer problems, we will be having only these many terms involved. So this is the basically element matrix equation. Let me put that correctly. Okay, this is going to be the element matrix equation for a linear bar element. Okay, linear bar element. As I said, this is only possible. Okay, this term is only possible in heat transfer through extended surfaces like fins. Okay, where heat transfer also happens through convection. Then this term will get involved. At all other times, this term will be absent. Okay, this term will be absent, and the matrix will only be of the first term, which is element stiffness multiplied by displacement matrix. Displacement vector matrix is equal to force vector matrix. Okay, if there are any additional loading like distributed loading, then it can be added onto the right hand side. So I hope this is clear. So this is the element matrix equation for a linear bar element. Considering a default differential equation, okay, or standard differential equation. So I hope you have liked this content, and if you have liked the video, please share it with everyone and subscribe to my channel to keep getting the new content. Okay, thank you very much. I'll see you next time.